They've made me feel like a prisoner. They've made me feel set free. They've made me feel like a criminal. Made me feel like a king. They've lifted my heart to places I've never been. And they've dragged me down back to where I began.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Good afternoon. This is Pastor Dale. It is Monday, January 20th, where I'm recording this, 2020. And it's Martin Luther King Day, and how thankful I am to the Lord Jesus Christ for Dr. Martin Luther King. He truly set an example for all people of all nations, all races. You know, he didn't have an ounce of prejudice in him. And I really admire and respect that man a lot. I remember growing up as a kid. I grew up in the 50s and the 60s. I was born in 1946. So I kind of remember what went on in the 50s and 60s. And I remember in the 60s when the Civil Rights Movement was going on in this nation. And I remember Dr. Martin Luther King very, very vividly. As a matter of fact, it was my desire. I wanted to go down south to be in one of the marches and to work with him. I never got down there, but I really did want to go down because I felt that the work that he was doing was fantastic. I remember, I forgot what year it was, 69 or 70, something like that, that, you know, racism was still felt in the South. And I had a friend of mine. I was living in a small town in upstate New York called Oneida, New York. It's in central New York, central part of New York State near Syracuse. And it was, you know, the home of Oneida Silver. I'm sure everybody's heard of that. And my buddy, I was with a friend of mine. His nickname was Satch, and he was an American Indian from the tribes up there in that area of the Oneida Indians. And, you know, Satch had expressed to me how he too had felt the impact, even upstate New York, of the prejudice that was against the American Indians at that time. Not only blacks, but against American Indians and against, I'm not sure what was going on with my race, but it seemed like they were out against everybody at that particular point. So Satch and I decided we would travel down to Florida, and we loaded up the car and we took off down to his grandparents' house in Smyrna, Florida, Smyrna Beach, I believe it was, Florida. So we drove down and we came into real early in the morning. We were traveling, and we came into Georgia, I believe it was Georgia, and as we entered into Georgia, I noticed that I needed fuel, gas for the car, so I decided that I would pull over to the nearest gas station, and we found one coming off the interstate. I forgot what highway I was on, but it was an interstate. And as we came off the interstate, we pulled in and we saw two service stations, one on the left and one on the right, as we pulled off the exit. And the one on the left seemed quite busy, but the one on the right, it didn't seem like anybody's there. So I thought, well, geez, I don't feel like going to a busy gas station. I want to get gas and get up out of here. So we pulled into the right, and all kinds of guys came out to help us. You know, washed the windshield, washed the back windows, checked everything in the car and filled the car up, checked the oil. And it was all black people. And I thought, this is really cool. So, you know, I noticed that the blacks kind of looked at me like, what's going on with this white guy here, you know? And come to find out that the reason there was nobody in their station, because the station across the street was a white-owned station, and that's all that was there was white people. And the white people noticed the white guy over in this black station. So needless to say, I got some odd looks that night. And Satch noticed the same thing, and he said, I don't know if I'm too comfortable here, Dale. So we decided to fill the car up, and we thanked everybody. Because, I mean, the guys were so nice to us, man. You know, and they helped us find our way back, and we did a little chatting, and they told us, yeah, there was a little bit of a racism thing going on down there, but they weren't worried about it. Nobody had bothered them, but they said that you will probably, they thought it was a miracle that nobody had come up into the gas station to harass me, simply because I had pulled into a black gas station. They didn't pull up in there, but later on down the road, a few miles down the road, I did notice a sheriff did follow me for quite a while. We never got pulled over, anything like that, but we felt the impact of racism at that time. So we continued our trip on down to Smyrna Beach, Florida, to be with his grandparents. And even down there, you know, even where there's quite a few American Indians down there, and down there we just felt the racism. And so I kind of had developed a heart of this battle against racism in this nation. As a matter of fact, several years later, I even joined the NAACP, and I got to know some of the people there, and just a terrific organization. You know, Sherman Travis was a friend of mine. Leroy Mobley, who was at one point, he was the director of the prison chapters of the NAACP, and I got to know him quite well. And wonderful man of God as well. So I got to know Leroy and the NAACP, got to know some other ones, and it was quite an organization. And they were really, at that point, they were really truly fighting hard against racism. So I had developed that, and then on the way back, you know, we got talking about different things, Satch and I did, and about the different issues going on in this nation. And Satch, to a lot of people, was just people up in my hometown, not my hometown, but the area where I lived in, Oneida. Some people who knew Satch, white people, had considered Satch just a stupid kid, and he wasn't. Satch was a very intelligent man, but the problem was nobody was giving him an opportunity, which is what I see today going on. I work with homeless people, and I see that going on today, that sometimes people don't want to give people an opportunity to do something, to show them, like, hey, I'm a smart man. I know one man in Frederick, Maryland, who's from Kenya, and this young man is so intelligent and has skills and abilities that is just unbelievable, but nobody's willing or ready to give him a chance to prove himself and to show, this is what I can do. You know, and he's a very, very intelligent man. And it really kind of saddens me and breaks my heart that I see him and other people that are homeless, who are black, or maybe of another race or of another culture, and they're just really not given a fair chance by a lot of people in the community to show themselves, and nobody's willing to reach out to help them, and that really kind of disturbs me. Now, the organization I work for, which is the Religious Coalition, they do. I work for a great organization, I really do. The Religious Coalition in Frederick, Maryland, is a coalition that really serves and helps everybody. You know, believe me, they help everybody. Anybody comes in there, they don't give a rat's banana. Never heard that word before, did you? Rat's banana. Anyways, they don't give a rat's banana whether you're white, black, old, young, gay, straight, transvestite. Doesn't make any difference to them whether you're a religious person, a non-religious person, whether you're a Catholic or a Muslim. They just don't care. Their whole thing is, we're here to help people. You know, and that's what I like about the coalition that I work for, because they really do help a lot of people. And the executive director, Nick Brown, does a tremendous job in running the organization, because you can see Nick's heart in it, because Nick is a very serious individual who takes his job very serious, and he takes the coalition and their purpose in life and purpose in the town and in the county very seriously. And he really does go out, him and Catherine Dorsey, they really truly go out of their way to help a lot of people. And if they can't help people themselves, they go out of their way to find help for people. So these are the type of people that I like to be around. It's like my church that I belong to, Pastor Charlotte and Pastor Richard, Pastor Jerry, who was the senior pastor, the pastor who looks on. He's no longer there. He's at another location now. Pastor Charlotte, Pastor Richard are the pastors there. But between Pastor Richard and Pastor Charlotte, Pastor Jerry, we got quite a crew of pastors, right? And Jerry's wife, Nisi, Evangelist Anita. I'm telling you, these people, you see it in them, man. You feel it in them. You hear it in their voice. You see it in their actions. They just love to help people. And I'm telling you, these are the type of people that I really, really enjoy hanging around. I mean, I really, really do. Because, my gosh, man, their heart is real. And their heart shows to me these, you know, like especially the people in the church, their heart shows me these are Christians. My bishop, Bishop Robert Grayson, oh my gosh. Man, if you guys got to know this guy, he's one of the most unique, wonderful brothers in the world. And I just absolutely love the man to death. Brother and Elder Leon Swanson is another guy. I mean, he just reaches out to people. Now, he's a man who's never been to prison, but he has a prison ministry. He has a heart for prisoners. And it blesses me to watch him and to see the things that he does. It's absolutely amazing. And his heart is there, him and his wife both. My gosh, man, it just thrills me that I'm with people like this, and the people that I hang out with, Lorraine and Deborah and Mark and other ones. I just love these people to death, man. I really do. Praise God. But anyways, so what I wanted to talk on today, I guess I took a little bit of a rabbit trail, huh? But the words mean a lot. For example, Dr. Martin Luther King's speech, you know, about I had a dream and one day, and then he went on and on. The words that he said were explosive. They were powerful. They had meaning. They had feeling from his heart. And that was the amazing thing, is that it was from his heart. It wasn't just from his head. This man put his heart into that speech. And he meant every single word that he said. And it was just like Abraham Lincoln when he gave his speech 47 years ago, the Gettysburg Address. This man felt that. This man knew what he was writing. It was real. I mean, words played an important part in their life before all the internet stuff, because today kids don't even know how to do cursive writing. I'm surprised that some of them even know how to do any reading. But it's so important that we pay attention to our words, and we know how to handle words, that we know how to speak proper words, how to write proper words, and how to display our feelings through our words. And it's so important that we pay attention to what we say and what we do. So I was going through the book of Proverbs, and I found a lot of great passages in Proverbs dealing with the mouth, dealing with the tongue. Oh my gosh, look, in the book of James, let me pull this out real quick. In the book of James, I think is one of the most profound, one of the most powerful verses. If you're following along, praise God. Follow along. If you're not, well, you're missing out on something. No, I'm just kidding. At least you're listening, right? Praise God. All right, so listen to what James wrote. Now, James, of course, is the physical brother of Jesus Christ. And this is what he wrote. He's talking about the tongue. Well, that thing there, right? Okay. And notice he says that, wow, where is that? Praise God. There's one part here. Okay. Verse 5. So also the tongue is a small part of the body, and yet it boasts great things. Behold, how great a forest is set aflame by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a very word of iniquity. The tongue is set among our members as that which defiles the entire body, and sets on fire the course of our life, and is set on fire by hell. Man, I don't know about you, but that's a troublesome verse, man. I mean, the tongue is so important. Now we're beginning to see why the author of Proverbs followed God's lead and said that death and life are in the power of the tongue. Because, you know, death is part of life, right? But we can kill people from our words, because our words are set on fire by the very hell itself. Amen? So we got to be careful. We have to learn to tame that tongue. And that's what James is going on to talk about. He said, but no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil and full of deadly poison. Now compare this to what he was just talking about. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And right here, James is saying the same thing. Amen? Praise God. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the likeness of God. From the same jaws, right? Ah, right there, all right? Come both blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be this way. Now, you can tell James was the brother of Jesus, because words are important. And we know in Jesus, Jesus spoke only great words and words of encouragement, words that build up. He never tore anybody down except for the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And boy, did he get on their case, right? Woo! All right, praise God. But we can see here from James, with James, this is important. This is an important part of the Bible. And then if we get back over to Ephesians, you want to turn back to the book of Ephesians chapter 4. Listen to this. Listen. Please, please, just listen, listen. Maybe I'm stepping on your toes. If I am, big deal. You get over it. Anyways, verse 29. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth. All right? But only such a great word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Now, considering the mouth again, listen to what Paul finishes up with. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with malice. Where does all that come from? How can you do all that? Through the tongue. Amen? You show bitterness and express bitterness with the tongue. You show wrath, express wrath through the tongue. You can show anger through the tongue. Clamor through the tongue. Slander through the tongue. Gossip through the tongue. Words of hate through the tongue. So we can see that the tongue plays a very vital, important part in the Christian walk. Then getting over to chapter 5 of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 4. And there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. Wow. Is God saying something to us there or what? You know? So anyway, so looking at all this and considering all this, so I went into the book of Proverbs. Praise God. All right? So I went into the book of Proverbs, and I found a few proverbs. So just go along with me for a minute here. It says, the mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence. Proverbs 10:11. On the lips of the discerning, wisdom is found, but a rod is for the back of him who lacks understanding. Wise men store up knowledge, but with the mouth of the foolish, ruin is at hand. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. That's Proverbs 10, verse 14. He who conceals hatred has lying lips, and he who spreads slander is a fool. All of this is relating to the tongue. I'm telling you, man, you know, how do you get forgiveness? You ask God, using your tongue, Father, forgive me for my sins. Father, I have made a mistake. Father, I have goofed up. You know, this is how we seek forgiveness. Now, someone asked me one day asked a question about, what about the deaf mutes? Okay, listen, they have the signs, all right? They do their signing. I can't, trust me, I can't sign. But I do know this one. All right, praise God. All right. Means I love you. So we think about the tongue, even with them. No, they can't use their tongue, but they can sign and they can write, and it's in their minds. Amen. So we need to be careful. We need to be very careful. Where I work in the shelter, that we have a couple of deaf mutes there. And I just love these two people. I mean, they're so silly, but they read my lips. The deaf people know how to read the lips. They understand what you're saying. You don't have to go around like this. Do you understand what I'm saying? No, you don't have to. Just speak your normal language, your normal voice, using your normal lips, and they can understand. You see, that's the whole thing. You don't think they understand, but they understand every single thing that you're saying. Wow. So if you're making fun of them, better knock it off. Amen? So those are just a few. You know, the tongue of the righteous is as choice silver. The heart of the wicked is worth little. Amen? The lips of the righteous feed many. But fools die for lack of understanding. Wow. The mouth of the righteous flows with wisdom, but the perverted tongue will be cut out. Man, if that's the case, wow, they did that today. Good God Almighty, wouldn't be too many of us in this world that have to be around, be able to speak, would we? Praise God. The lips of the righteous bring forth an acceptable. What is acceptable? But the mouth of the wicked, what is perverted. Wow. I mean, there's so much. He who goes about as a talebearer reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy conceals a matter, all with a tongue. An evil man is ensnared by his transgression of his lips, but the righteous will escape from trouble. A man will be satisfied by with good by the fruit of his words, and the deeds of a man's hands will return to him. Man, listen. He who speaks truth tells what is right, but a false witness, deceit. Man, there's so much in the Bible, man. Truthful lips will be established forever, but a lying tongue is only for a moment. Wow. I'm telling you guys, there's so much here. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal faithfully are his delight. There is so much in the Bible about the tongue, and that's why I have been speaking a lot on it lately, because our tongues and what we say is so important, so very important. So when you go to the grocery store and you see maybe the clerk looks like she's a little stressed out or he's a little stressed out, or you go through a drive-in and you know maybe the cashier snaps at you a little bit, say something kind to them. You know, tell them, you know, things like, say things like, you know, I do understand what you're going through, and I just want you to know that I'm praying for you. You would be surprised what would happen there. A couple of years ago, I belonged to an organization called the Water Boys for Jesus, with Paul Foss as our CEO. And every Christmas, Paul has the different groups. We meet at what they call tables, different spots throughout the city of Frederick. And now we're in other countries. We sponsor a family at Christmas time. And then we go out and we do some shopping for them. And so we were at Walmart 2 years ago, and I was with some goofy water boy friends of mine that just love to get me in trouble. they really do, but I wouldn't trade them for all the money in the world. But anyways, so we were up there. We were at Walmart's in Frederick, Maryland, up on Guilford Drive. And coming through the line, there was an older black lady, and she was waiting on us. She was a cashier, and you could tell she was under a little bit of stress. And I'm up there to the front because I have all the money, right? And so I'm handing out the money to her. And I says, you look a little stressed. She says, man, you have no idea. She says, this is a tough job. And it has to be during Christmas time. People got to be snapping at them. And, you know, people are stupid and all this stuff. You know, they hear all kinds of itty stuff. But I said, you know what, lady? I said, ma'am. I said, God loves you and so do we. And I said, matter of fact, hey, can I make your day? And she says, yeah. So I did. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Listen, I did that song for her, and that woman wanted to pass out. She really did. She said, you just have no idea what you did for me. And the woman next to her and the other cashier, she come right over. She said, do it again, do it again. And people were starting to form around. But it's because I took the time to be kind. I took the time to give them a good word, even through a song. We even did I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. And I'm telling you, man, you could do so much with your tongue to bless people's lives. Amen? Do that. It's not Christmas. It's Martin Luther King Day. We're heading towards spring and then summer, and we'll do the whole Christmas thing over in a few months. Don't want to remind you of that, but it's coming. Anyways, Merry Christmas 2020. I'll get a head start. Anyways, so stop and think before you speak and bless somebody's life, please. What is it, Roger Rabbit? Please. Bless somebody's life. Be kind to somebody. That's the one thing. I'm not a big fan of Ellen DeGeneres, but she says one thing at the end that I really appreciate. Be kind to one another. And I really do respect that. And I respect anybody that speaks good words and good kinds. Encourage people. You know, that's the problem with our youth today. People need to encourage them. People need to stop putting them down. Parents, stop putting your children down. Stop preaching to them and start teaching them through your lifestyle of what it's like to be a good man or a good woman. God bless you. I hope you got something out of this. If you did, I'd love to hear from you. And I got to say a special hello and shout out to my friend Alex and Carolyn and Ray. Oh, all the people from Grand Canyon who I went to school with. Helen, Carolyn Gillamy, just all of you. You're the most blessed, wonderful people. I love you all. And to my professors out there, God bless you. Have a great day in the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, God loves you. Jesus loves you. The Holy Spirit fills you and loves you. And so do I. God bless you. Can't wait. Bye.
They've made me feel like a prisoner. They've made me feel set free. They've made me feel like a criminal. Made me feel like a king. They've lifted my